Story says Ghana's debt soars by 200% in just 4 years. The story is suggesting that Ghana's public debt stock has grown by a whopping $70 billion, representing a 200% increase in the last 4 years. Now, total public debt moved from $35.1 billion in 2012 to $105 billion in March 2016. And according to the finder, it was confirmed by the finance minister, Mr. Setekpe. Now, Mr. Setekpe also told us just in the week and the review that our public debt had gone down from, I think, 72 to 63%. Let me start with Dr. Kofi Olinsi. You're an economist, and this issue of debt and whether it is up or down, and the fact that when you borrow to undertake infrastructure projects, it is labeled wise borrowing and all that. We're told that in 4 years our debt soared 200%.
Yes.
How would an economist describe something like that?
You see, there are two types of debts: the debt we owe to ourselves domestically,
right,
and the debt we owe externally. When we take the domestic portion of it and look at interest rates,
35%.
You ask yourself, if you do not pay that debt, how many times, when can it increase to 100%? You do it 30%, three times.
Okay. And it's almost there.
Exactly. So if it's not been paid, that's a problem. Now, of course, we've had periods when we have been relying on oil revenue to do most of the things that, when previously there was nothing there. We've not done anything. We've not been as serious to encourage production, domestic production of things. And therefore, when we look, we become almost a service economy where people just come in and just trade and just go away. And so a large portion of our own population is actually unemployed and not contributing incomes. This is a recipe for disaster, especially when the debt load becomes as high. So once you go beyond 60%, or even once you increase, a small increase bloats everything up. Okay, so I'm not surprised to see that Ghana's debt has increased. But the most important is not that the debt is an issue. Debt is an issue. But we are not using the borrowings that we actually have been making to do the right things. We are not ensuring that the incomes or the returns that we're getting from the debt is enough to pay for the cost of the debt. And that is where we are having our problem. You see, you cannot borrow to just spend.
To invest in right.
To just consume. You have to spend to ensure that you are making more than what is costing you. So if it's increased by that much, then it clearly shows that we are not making wise decisions in terms of our borrowings. I mean, when I look at some of the borrowings that we've had in the past, I saw one which it actually incensed me. They were going to borrow about $35 million to go and build Cantonmanto, from China. Borrow $35 million from China. I looked at it and I said, look, what do you need to build Cantonmanto? You don't need inputs from China and all that. I mean, I look at, Kanishi, and I see what had happened. Achampong built it, domestic, this is now going to borrow the money. So it looked like almost everything we did, because we thought it was easy, we just go around, borrow it. Okay, and therefore, that sense of carefulness in choosing debt in order to ensure that they pay more than that, that is not as taken as seriously, and it's it's showing. And we need to be very clear. But at the end of the day, we are going to pay it by future taxes.
I see. I'm grateful. Dr. Osain, the finance minister said that our debt levels are going, that the public debt is now down to about 63%. We're a bit scared when it was going around the 70s, and we're no more talking of HIPC. That's according to the finance minister. But The debt itself, Dr. Lindsay is suggesting that, like he said, it's not the debt itself, but how you put it after taking it. Mm-hmm. And he's suggesting that perhaps we're not doing the right thing where we're putting these money.
In financing, debt is a source of financing. Mm-hmm. And the source of the debt or the source of the financing is critical. Mm. But you see, as a nation, we should have come to the realization that the very year we pronounce that we are a middle income country, mm-hmm. it affects our everything, including our borrowing capacity, mm. where we can borrow, how we can borrow, and because access to concessionary loans and grants may not be available to you, or it will be available on different terms. And if you borrow to finance recurrent expenditure, you don't expect to have any positive multiplier effect mm-hmm. in the economy. Mm-hmm. It means you borrow to consume. Mm-hmm. If you borrow to consume, then repayment becomes difficult because you are repaying the principal plus interest. And aside from that, if you also, because we realize that we found oil, mm. we relaxed a little bit in our revenue mobilization landscape. So you realize that when the Minister of Finance appeared before Parliament in his supplementary budget and budget review report, he indicated that revenue within the first half year of this year has fallen. Why is that the case? Because we set the projections, the revenue generating agencies, are they not working? If the revenue levels have fallen, then it means we have to cut our expenditure. Unfortunately, we're not able to cut our expenditure within mm-hmm. the period. So we ran deficit. And then it is now compelling him to go to Parliament for additional 1.8. The next question is that if you borrow, as Dr. Lindsay said, you can borrow domestically or you go outside. If you borrow domestically, it has economic effect. Mm-hmm. Because once the government goes out there to borrow, you compete with the private sector. Mm-hmm. You crowd them out. You push interest rate high. So it becomes very difficult for the private sector to even go and borrow. Mm. Or even if they can borrow at all, they borrow at a higher interest rate. And if you borrow at a higher interest rate, it affects your pricing. Mm-hmm. And if it affects your pricing, it's the average Ghanaian that suffers. You know, so the borrowing levels are very high. We should concern ourselves with what we borrow for. Mm-hmm. If we borrow for infrastructure, it has a positive multiplier. Mm-hmm. If we borrow to finance recurrent expenditure, salaries and wages, personnel emolument, it doesn't help. I would have wished that we finance those things from our internally generated revenue.
Mm-hmm. There is the money here.
There is money here. There is. I can tell you that there is money here. If we put systems right, we'll be able to mobilize it. Mm-hmm. It is because we are not upscaling most of the required mobilization strategies. It's also because we are not able to connect taxes to service delivery. The average Ghanaian has an eye and intent for quality. Mm-hmm. If you are able to prove to the average Ghanaian that I collect these taxes, I'll use it to do this, and they see that they are benefiting from it, they'll be prepared to pay. Mm-hmm. Let us align it with the work of the churches. If they want to mobilize, they want to go on a convention or a harvest, mm-hmm. and they tell them that we are organizing this harvest to build that particular school, and the church believes that that school will be built, you will get people dancing and walking to make donations. Why? Because they believe that the thing will be done. But if we don't conscientize Ghanaians, that will be able to connect the payment of taxes to service delivery. They don't see it. It becomes difficult for people to pay. Again, we have so many exemptions in this country. So many exemptions in this country. We have a number of companies that are working. Mm. You give them 5 years exemption, they are not paying taxes. After 5 years, you see them converting or changing over from one company to the other. We see all these things. What are we doing about it? The Dutch disease, in my view, I think, is gradually affecting us. Oh, because we found oil, we have relaxed in coming out with new revenue areas, and we want to over-rely on oil. And now oil prices
are
also falling.
And the revenues are not too.
Revenues are also
Professor Chidolu, so if government is talking about fiscal consolidation, then this borrowing must stop.
And the way I see it is this. In 2012, they said our debt was what? 35.1 billion. Is that correct?
Right.
In 2016, it's 105
billion.
Billion.
Mm. That will confirm just this week.
Yes, big time. Any primary school child knows the difference between 35 and 105.
But we're dreaming big, so we're asking for.
No problem. No problem. We can borrow all the money we want to borrow. And provided we do something with it and show for it. That's fantastic. Mm. But let's look between 2012 to 2016. Let's look at some indicators. Has our economy expanded within that time? By how much? Look at the percentage increase in the debt. And see the corresponding percentage increase, if there's increase at all.
Mr. Tekpe says the economy is on the transformation path.
Transformation path. We will get there. But you are now in 2006. The figure we have here is for 2016. Mm. I'm comparing 2012 with 2016. Money borrowed 2012 is $35 billion. Mm. Money borrowed 2016 is $105 billion. Mm. Fantastic. Now let's compare it. Supposing the debt was borrowed, the debt was incurred for us to do something. Mm-hmm. Is that correct?
Right.
To move the economy, infrastructure development, the schools, okay, the hospitals, the roads, the electricity. Is that not correct? Mm. Very good. Has those things move up between 2012 and 2016? Let's not go too much into economic stuff. Let's just put it down to where the lay person. We're all here in 2012. Most of us are still here in 2016. Let's all go to indicators. Has your life improved by that much from $35 billion to $105 billion in terms of debt? Have we improved? Has the electricity situation improved? Has the whole infrastructure improved, really? It might have improved in some circumstances, but not by that big lump, leap. The economy. The unemployment is going up. So the question is that, yes, we have $105 billion as debt now. What did we do with that money? And the Minister of Finance said, well, we are doing infrastructure development. It will take time for it to manifest itself. Okay, probably let's give it time. Let's say we are still transforming. Is that correct? Mm. But to the ordinary guy at Konkope today, at Lima, at Lagos Town, or anywhere in Ghana today, if they hear this, they know the difference between $35 billion and $105 billion. You don't need to be a professor to know that. Is that correct? And then that's they said, let's compare that to your system. We borrowed, I said, what did you get all that money for? Oh, okay. To develop the country, the roads and this thing. They asked, I said, look, my neighborhood is still the same. In fact, today I didn't get electricity. So what exactly are you spending this money on? Or is it no? The blowing up of the debt is just because of the interest we are going to pay on it. So for me, the fundamentals is this. The finance minister can go and borrow all the money you want to borrow. But at the end of the day, it must show us the evidence that these things are transforming our lives. For me, the economy, we talked about the growth rate last night, which was coming down. Is that correct? Mm. A lot of things are coming down. Then what exactly are we doing with this money we borrow? But as Doc said, we are all going to pay this money. You see, the thing about debt is that when you borrow, until you used to buy Kelly Willie and eat. You didn't use it to develop anything.
Okay.
You are going to pay for it. So for me, this debt is worrying because I cannot see the corresponding increase in our lives vis-a-vis the increase in the debt. Probably the finance minister knows something we don't know.
Okay, all right. Nana.
Let me leave it to you.
Professor Jidolo has taken the
money. No.
Let me leave it to you.
You know, I'll start with GDP. 2012, GDP growth was 7.3. 2013, GDP growth was 6.7. 2014, it came to 4.3. And last year, we ended at 3.9.
So there's always a drop there.
7.3, 6.7, 4.3. Last year, we ended up 3.9. Now, factually, the finance minister said that we borrowed $5 billion as at the first quarter of 2016. Mm. Now, some of us monitor government issuance of debt every day. And by our calculation, which is confirmed by the Business Finder, government borrowed $17.3 billion.
And not $5 billion.
Not $5 billion, which is confirmed. I mean, if you look at the Business Finder, it says it that government sources, government sources.
You're blocking your mic. Sorry. Right.
Okay. Page 2. Page 3 says, government sources indicate that only $5 billion was added to the debt stock within the first 3 months of 2016. Business Finders checks, however, revealed that government had borrowed $17.36 billion by the end of the first quarter. Now, if you also listen to what Dr. Esibe said. Dr. Esibe said that you cannot say you are pursuing fiscal consolidation and still maintain loose expenditure levels, particularly when your revenues are low. He warned against government's resort to increasing taxes in a bid to rake in more revenue, noting that frequent increment in taxes is itself inimical to the performance of the economy because high tax revenue has been shown to stifle economic growth as it increases the tax avoidance, evasion, and fraud. Now, when you compound this situation with government crowding the private sector in terms of debt issuance, and when this also becomes an issue in terms of our debt, let's assume that the government is right. Our debt profile now is 107 billion. A population of 25 million people. Just to put it in layman's terms, that means that when you divide 107 billion, every Ghanaian now owes 4.2 million Ghana cedis. And assuming the exchange rate is 4 cedis to $1, that means that Bright, as you sit here today, averagely, you owe $1 million.
I see.
This is what the government is saying. I am not cooking up these figures. I'm saying that if the numbers are 107 billion, that means that 107 billion divided by 25 million people, you get 4.28 million per person. Your GDP is going down. Your debt per citizen is beyond comprehension. Your debt stock is going up. Next year, by October 2017, Ghana will have to redeem its first Eurobond of $1 billion, which was issued under the President Kufuor's government in 2007. I haven't seen a sinking fund nor any provision in our budget stating that we have this debt coming up and therefore we are making these provisions towards the payment of that debt when it matures in 2017. We are still going to go into the market before the end of this year to issue another $1 billion in euro bonds with all the issues going on with Brexit, with the global terror attacks in Europe, with America uncertain of its future because of this election year. We, Ghana, as we sit now, still want to go into this market to borrow $1 billion only to pay the maturing obligations of debt. And as the professor said, it doesn't make economic sense to borrow to pay recurring debt. That is not how you sustain the economy. But, right, it is also important, as we sit here, to look at things holistically. What is government faced with that has caused this? The budget, the assumption for revenue for crude oil was $58 per barrel. Oil went down as low as $28 per barrel. That means that whatever government's projection was,
it's thrown off board.
It's been reduced by 50% in terms of, because oil now brings in close to about $3 billion a year. So to have your oil revenue reduced by 50%, that has a monumental effect on your projections. Commodity prices, cocoa, gold, falling. The appetite is going down. Our balance of payment, that is, our imports versus our exports, last year was close to $5 billion. That is our trade deficit, purely because of the energy crisis and our inability to manufacture and our inability to be competitive. We have a crisis on our hands. What I wish would be the Honorable Minister...
Is it a crisis we are seeing?
Of course. Yes. We are in a crisis situation.
The problem is just said this is an economy that is on that path.
No. You see, that is what I'm saying, that You can tickle yourself all you want, but that is a different scenario. Professor Jinonu said it. 35 billion to 105 billion, you don't need to be a professor to know what is going on. What the Honorable Minister needs to do is to face the nation and say, ladies and gentlemen, we have a problem. We do have a problem. We need to fix this energy, and this energy is not going to be a quick and easy solution. It is going to cost us. We've allowed things to degenerate, because there's one thing with generating power. That is one aspect of it. The other aspect is the transmission and distribution, the loopholes within the system, the public debt in terms of not non-payments to ECG, the debt of ECG to GridCo, and GridCo's indebtedness to VRA, and VRA's indebtedness to the gas companies in Nigeria, and what have you. We also have a foreign exchange issue, and that is why the bank of the IMF came to our rescue. IMF only came to our rescue because of balance of payment support, whereby we are not generating enough foreign exchange to pay our imports. We have a crisis. And sometimes it's almost as if you have a problem in the house where you need to sit down with your wife and break down the details to her, and you'll be amazed how compassionate and understanding your wife will be. So I feel that the Honorable Minister should really come back again and explain to Ghanaians that this is where we are. And I believe that he'll be amazed at the fact that Ghanaians are critical thinkers, they'll be compassionate, and we will all come on board to assist the economy, because at the end of the day, it is Ghana first, not NPP, not NDC, not CPP. It is about Ghana.
Okay.
And once we all are on board, just like the professor said, that when you go to church and you know that we want to buy a bus, and this harvest is about buying this bus that will convey us to all our conventions and crusades, everybody comes out there to contribute because they believe in the cause. Let us believe in the cause, and we'll share the pain and agony, and we'll all go on this journey together. But when it comes out as if this is the best performing economy, our debt has shrunk, we've slowed down debt since we went to EPIC, that's what has been said.
All right.
Those are tickling yourself, and it doesn't make anybody happy.
Unfortunately, we'll have to wrap up the conversation this morning here. I'm sorry, we ran out of time. Nana Fedra Pamwo is Executive Director of Investpo Limited, and I'm grateful for your time this morning. Professor Clement Jijono is the President of the Accra Institute of Technology. Prof, thanks so much for joining us. Dr. Kofi Olins-Lintse is an economist and lawyer. We're grateful for your time too. And Dr. Eriko Drosa is the Dean of the Institute of Local Government. And yes, local government studies, also for research. Doc, I'm also grateful for your time this morning.
Pleasure.
Thank you so much, gentlemen, for joining me. We have